And thanks everyone for being here tonight. Tonight I will tell you how my research group is tackling respiratory disease using fluid mechanics. And now, if you don't know what fluid mechanics is, don't worry, you're not alone. I could define fluid mechanics as the science of how anything flows from the air around the wings of an airplane, but also the hot water in the heating system in your household. But tonight, I'll also show you how fluid mechanics can help us understand how things work or sometimes don't work in our lungs. Well, let me start with a little detective stories, though. Consider five heavy smokers. Statistically speaking, one of them will get a disease called the chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, or COPD. The others, we don't care. They might have other diseases. They might have lung cancer, or maybe they're lucky and they just have a bad breath. But statistically speaking, one of them will get COPD, and I want to know why. First, I should really define what COPD is, so let me Google that for you. According to the Mayo Clinic website, which we all trust, COPD is a lung disease that obstructs the airflow in your lungs, making it hard to breathe. And that's because mucus and inflammation really strangles the airways, which we call bronchitis. And sometimes even the deep air spaces can be damaged, which we call emphysema. This disease is caused by exposure to irritating substances such as cigarette smoke, but also other airborne particles. And it's a chronic disease, so if you have it, it will likely stay with you for the rest of your life. Now, how common is a COPD? Unfortunately, it is extremely common. We know that there are now more than 15 million cases diagnosed only in the US. And the scariest part to me is that out there, there's another 12 million Americans that have the disease without even knowing they have it. And that's because the symptoms are just cough, mucus, breath difficulties, whereas a full diagnosis requires an X-ray scan. And this disease doesn't only make your life miserable, it can actually kill you. It is, in fact, the third leading cause of death in the United States, after only heart disease and cancer. Outside of the United States, the situation is even worse, because smoke is not the only cause of COPD. Poor air quality also can cause it. And in fact, outside of the United States, the situation is even worse. Look at this graphic. This is how many cases, how much the cases of COPD have increased in the last 30 years. And outside of the United States and in the Western world, probably because we all quit smoking in the 90s, right? The increase has been only 18%. Not much, but look at China. Almost 200% increase. Latin America, 300%. Middle East, 700%. India, 1,400%. Are you kidding me? This is an overwhelming, this is an epidemic spread. One of the reasons for this epidemic spread is that we don't understand enough about this disease. So here are a few urgent questions we are trying to answer. Why only some people get COPD? Can we diagnose it before it's too late? And can we predict who will get worse? Now, I am no doctor, I'm an engineer. And I believe that if we are to understand this disease, if we are to answer those questions, we first need to understand the physical mechanism behind this disease. So let me turn to my friend there, the smoker from the oil painting, and ask him, after you smoke and you have a particle of smoke entering your nose, what happens? How does it fly through your lungs? Well, I can't ask him because he's dead. But that's no problem. Dead people can always teach us valuable lessons. This man, he's dead, but he will be kind enough to let me enter his nose and fly through his airways, because that's a cadaver that was scanned by X-rays at high resolution. So now we're going to enter into his nose. You ready? It's going to be gross. Told you. So this is the nasal cavity, which is very narrow, right? And past that, we're going to enter at the back of his mouth into the pharynx. Now, past that constriction you see over there, which is the epiglottis, we have the larynx. And at some point, you're going to see a triangular opening right there. Those are the vocal folds. And past, we enter the trachea, this long tube that eventually splits into the two lungs. We're going to take a left, and we go to the left lung. And then we can take a right or a left. I guess we'll go right, or maybe down or up. We're navigating to this labyrinth that is our bronchi, until eventually, just like a particle of smoke, boom, we hit a wall and we stick. Now, the same technology that is giving me this reconstruction gave us common X-ray scans. Except usually an X-ray scan looks to us just like a two-dimensional image. But the information behind is far richer. It allows us to reconstruct in three dimensions the trachea and the bronchi deep into our airways. And with that information, we can identify with certainty whether there is an inflammation, which really determines that you have or don't have COPD. But not only that. I believe we can use this information to find signs of COPD before it manifests itself. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to take scans, X-ray scans, from a number of subjects that underwent a clinical study that lasted 5 years. Those are people with moderate COPD. They all smoke the same amount of cigarettes. They have similar age, similar body build. After 5 years, though, some of them will be a lot worse, will have a much deteriorated ability to breathe. Others will be stable. And so what we can do is to come back and look at the scans at the beginning of the five-year period and ask, what is the difference between those that stay stable and those who get worse? And we're going to be looking for differences both in the anatomy, so the shape of the airway, and the airflow through the airways. Let's start with the anatomy. Sometimes your airways are called the bronchial tree. And if I flip this upside down, you know what that is, right? But now, is this a big fat baobab or a bear tree from a horror story? I need a measure that with one number tells me about the shape of this tree. So I'll turn to mathematics, to a concept called fractal dimension. If an object has a fractal dimension close to 3, it means it's shaped like a ball. If it has a fractal dimension close to 1, it means it's shaped more like a stick. So how do your lungs score? Well, we looked at several subjects, dozens of subjects, and that's what we found. Look at the healthy smokers. You know those people that smoke heavily all their life and they never have a difficulty to breathe? Well, these type of subjects had the highest fractal dimension, followed by the people that do have COPD, but they remain stable over time. And finally, the people that have COPD and have a decline in deteriorating ability to breathe, they had the lowest fractal dimension. So now, it looks like having a big fat tree is a lot better than having a skinny one. Great, we have a measure that gives an indication of how prone you are to develop the disease. But this is just a correlation, and I want causality. I want to know why. And to know why, I'm going to try and look at the flow through the airways. To do that, I'm going to take a very high-resolution scan of the airways and the airways alone. And I will use the power of model 3D printing to generate a faithful copy, a replica of the airways, with the precision of 1/1000th of an inch. Now I got myself a 3D printed patient, and then I can operate them as I please. I will attach it to a pump ventilator that produces a respiratory flow, and I will look at that flow. To do that with high precision, I will turn to another medical imaging technique that I'm sure you've heard about, MRI, magnetic resonance imaging. And you're looking at one of my graduate students placing my 3D printed patient on the table before an MRI scan. And all those tubes over there, well, those are just the tubes that bring the flow in from the ventilator. And what we get is a very detailed reconstruction of the flow through the airways. You see, we colored these particles in red when they move fast and in blue when they move slowly. And you can see how they describe complicated trajectories. In fact, those trajectories have some swirl to it. And as an engineer, that swirl is so interesting to me. Because it tells me that the flow through an airway is not only aligned with the airways itself. No, no, no. It actually has a rotational motion through it. It has a swirl. That is called secondary flow in fluid mechanics. And those secondary flow are very useful in engineering, for example, in a cyclone filter. This is a device used to purify air from impurities such as, guess what, particles. Essentially, those force a rotation of the flow that centrifuges the impure particles out, leaving the air clean. And I believe this is exactly the mechanism by which a healthy lung saves itself from harmful particles like cigarette smoke, by centrifuging them out, pushing them against the wall, making them stick on the mucus until, oops, I cough them out. Now, That's just a theory, really. But let's check it against facts. This plot shows you the strength of the secondary flow that we measured in our 3D printed patients, built replicating the anatomy of COPD patients that stayed stable versus COPD patients that got worse. In black, we have the data for the ones that stay stable. In red, for the COPD patients that were doomed to get worse. And as you can see, the stable patient had significantly higher secondary flows, more swirl in their airways, than the ones that were going to get worse. Now, you remember, the stable patients also had big fat airways, which makes sense, because if you have skinny bronchi, those secondary flows have no room to grow. So now we have a mechanism that doesn't only tell me that some people will get COPD and others won't. It actually tells me why. And more importantly, it tells me what to look for in a person's anatomy to determine if he or she is more inclined, more at risk of developing the disease. Obviously, this is based only on a limited number of subjects, but we want to expand. We want to mine the huge database offered by clinical studies, such as the one called COPD Gene, that recruited more than 10,000 patients over 20 clinical sites, including, fortunately for me, the University of Minnesota. With a database like that, I can access the clinical history and the x-rays of thousands of people. The data is already there. I just need to use it. The goal is to bring that number down, to reduce the number of cases, the millions of cases that every year are diagnosed too late or not at all. That's the only way to improve the lives of the millions of people that suffer from this disease, not only in the United States, but in the rest of the world. Well, the clock tells me that my time is almost up, but I really would like to conclude by thanking the people who are making this research possible. The first funding I ever got to do any research, really, came from the University of Minnesota. They believed in this work before anyone else. But later, I was lucky in finding support from Boston Scientific, National Science Foundation, and National Institute of Health. More importantly to me, though, let me thank the people, the amazing team who's doing all the work. They come from the fine continents, and each one of them brings something unique to the table. Ute Gerke, she's a phenomenal radiologist. Postdocs Andras and Omid. Graduate students Tristan and Sahar. And last but not least, Dr. Christine Wendt, she's here with us today. She's a phenomenal expert in COPD, a world leader in the matter, and she's a beautiful collaborator. For some reason, some 4 years ago, you chose to believe that my crazy ideas were not so crazy after all. Thank you all very much.